Welcome everybody. My name is Puck Curtis, and with me is my silent partner tonight, Eric Myers, who his microphone isn't working. And also with us is Lois Spangler, who's going to be our Spanish to English and back facilitator in case we run into any communication questions. And then our guest tonight is Dr. Manuel Valle. And he's been a friend to Mary and I for over 20 years. And the way that we met this individual, we had a website about 20 years ago with lots of Destreza things on it. And out of the blue, this person contacted us because he knew we were in California and he was flying in for a medical conference and he wanted to meet us. So we packed ourselves up into the car, we drove for an hour to San Francisco, and we had this lovely dinner with Dr. Valle, where we talked about the tradition. And then at the end of the evening, he gave us a small replica book that he had created just for us. And it's been this wonderful friendship and collaboration over the course of, I'd say, almost 20 years now. And we just cherish every part of that. So about him, he came to sport fencing a little later in life and migrated to Destreza. And he's been an advocate and researcher for Iberian traditions. He's worked for over 20 years, publishing 14 books on the subject. Most notably, perhaps, is the update to Leguina's Destreza bibliography, and then critical editions of treatises from Portugal and Spain. He's one of the founders of AGEA Editora, which has gifted the world with this collection of republished Destreza texts. And really, one of the most notable of those is Figueiredo's text, which was a lost manuscript published for the first time for the fencing community anywhere by Manuel's personal press. He's a lecturer on the history and culture and practice of the tradition. He's spoken in Spain, France, Scotland, Portugal, the United States, Italy, the Netherlands, and Belarus. And one of the nice things about having him into the United States for WMAW was that he was sort of the mastermind behind the fight that Tim and Ton and I had, where we represented three different parts of the tradition together. He was awarded an honorary title of Master at Arms by the HEMA Federation of Portugal. So he's a master doctor. And he's still an enthusiastic practitioner of the arts in Galicia and a friend to Destreza practitioners all over the world. And tonight he's going to speak to us about lost fencing books. All right, I'm turning it over to you, sir.
Thank you, Pac. I think that nice presentation. I am going to speak about a lot of fencing books that sometimes they were lost or sometimes they were recovered. In the stress up, there is a tradition or some kind of the lost kids or some kind of lost the prime books that were lost in some times. Actually, we have the precursors of Destreza, the books that were lost forever and they had never recovered. And also, in the course of history, there have been some books that have disappeared or sometimes in an unexpected. Some books appear that make things look different. And this, I think that this is going to happen. It's happening every day. So we have to expect that a lost fencing book can appear in any moment. Probably it's not to change completely everything, but it's to shed new light on some aspects of our practice that have no knowledge before. So this is an open world, And we are going to speak a little about how all this happened. This is a part of a presentation I have made before in Belarus and in Minsk. I have changed something and completed it. I have to say that as I want to show some images that are subjected to rights of copyrights, and so it's a disclaimer that it is not to you have to fair use or is it to show it, but you cannot reproduce it and use it for any another matters. So I am going to start the presentation. I think it is here now. It is okay. If somebody finds my hard disk, probably it's going to find a bolt of a lot of things. But I have a lot of material here. But this further elaboration, but. I try to put everything here, no? So some things are I guess here we start. No?
Yes, well, and okay. we can see your presentation, and just to warn you, we may ask questions as we go.
Well, yeah, it's no problem. Sometimes perhaps the sound is not quite well. I cannot understand everything, but if you speak slow and clear, I can understand everything. If any doubt, no problem. You can stop in any moment. It's not very long. We can talk about it. This is a kind of presentation of ideas that everything that is open, we can start speaking about it. It's not only directed to the Destreza, but only about in general about fencing books. So fencing books, we know that they are rare, that they are precious, and sometimes they are beautiful, or sometimes they are huge. So they were huge. Sometimes this is the case of the Paulus Hector Meyer books that they were produces. We have several exemplars. One of them you see in the right side. This is writing in German. In the middle, this is writing in Latin, or another one, this is writing in both German and Latin. There are three exemplars that are actually, there are one of them in the Saxony library, another one is the Bavari library, and the last one in both German and Latin is in the Austria National Library. They are very, very luxurious books with a lot of illustrations, a lot of color descriptions. But these people, Paul Hetterbeer, spend a lot of time, of money in these books. But actually, some people say that because he spent many of his time in books or money, or perhaps he used the money of the city of Augsburg, who was a civil servant. At the end of his life, which is of course in the 10th December of 1579, he was hanged. You see here the picture, because the officials of the city found that he has been cheated then with his expenses in books. So many people say that Paulus Hector Meyer was the first martyr, or so to speak, of books of the Destreza, no? Of fencing. So well, we have this as a reference of the love of fencing books. But now we're speaking about a mysterious book. Mysterious starts with the title, because we have no title. It has been called the Traité d'Assange or Livre de Leçons in French. It's supposed that his author was Pedro de Heredia, that was a Spanish military in the Netherlands in the 17th century. And the content is discussed. This is the Destreza of Bulga and the Destreza. This book, the form we have, for one side, this is a text book on one side, with a table of content, several additions, corrections also. But on the other side is another complementary book with plates. And this is we have seen, this is very rich plates with very illuminated with color. The script, the handscript of the textbook and the plates are different, but they are related. This book actually belongs to the collection of the Scott collection in Glasgow. This is the bequest of Scott, who was a shipbuilding tycoon in Glasgow in the beginning of the 20th century. He has a lot of fencing and armor and arms book and bequeathed all this collection to the city of Glasgow. Actually, it's not very accessible because it's concealed in a vault in a outskirts facility of Glasgow. We have very, very small glimpses of this. Some places have been reproduced in the work of Sidney Ganglo, but it's not easy to get access to this book. Which it is very, very, this kind of zancadilla, this is a kind of trick to get down your opponent. It's a mix of, for one side, the Destreza, but also of some kind of tricks of personal fight, of close fight. But
Manuel,
we have
one pregunta. I have a question.
Yes.
How many copies of the book exist?
Two copies. One copy is in Glasgow, and this you see here is the second copy. We have a second copy of this book, but exactly in Stockholm. This copy of the book is the same text and the same plates. The Stockholm copy has some more plates. You see that they are almost the same, but with small differences. You see here, this is the Stockholm copy. There has been a modern edition for Rob Rakers. And his basis on the Stockholm copies, because the Stockholm copies is more accessible and you can use them. The Glasgow copies is more difficult to access. And and say come to the question, because there is a copy in Stockholm, because it was a war prize, because the 31 years war, the Swedish troops took a German castle, and in this German castle it was a library, and they took the books back to Sweden. And between the books, this was a copy of this book. And so it is because in Sweden, actually, there is a copy of this book. Huh? It's a very, there are a lot of discussion about this book, because they said it is Destreza, it is not Destreza, it is Bulgar, it is just Bulgar. The ascription to Pedro de Heredia, it's probably marginal, because Pedro de Heredia perhaps was a owner during a time, but it's probably is not the author of this book, because it is written in French, and in a good French, and as everybody knows, Spanish people cannot speak French properly, and so yeah, it's a joke. And so probably the author was some people of the Low Countries environment, and in some times perhaps Pedro de Heredia was a owner or a promoter or something like that. But actually there are some parts of this book that are dealing with Destreza, with what they call the mathematical play. But some people find this is some correlation with Cavalcabo work, because there is some parts that are like a translation of Cavalcabo into French. No? So perhaps you have some kind of European French Flemish style of fencing, but it's in the variant of Destreza of or another kinds of fencing. Well, we are speaking about war. The war is a way of acquiring fencing books, and so in Moscow we have a book of Destreza. This is a copy of Carranza books that actually is in the National Library of Moscow. You can see here the location. And the provenance of this book is from the Bibliothèque of Dresden. After the Second World War, Russian take some as a compensation, some part of German bibliothèques, and take it to Russia. And this book is actually is in the National Library of Moscow. But the war also produced casualties of fencing books, and this is one of them. This is in the Library of Berlin, the National Library of Germany. We have the record of a book for this is a small book, but for Ignacy Polanco. Unfortunately, this is the only reference we have of this book, and probably it was the only copy. But as I say here, it's Krieg verlust. This is a loss of war. It was lost during the Second World War. I go there, I try to find this book. I ask for the books that were before and after this in the shelf. But unfortunately, all of them were missing. probably all the shelves was destroyed. I don't know, because it was a Russian shell or as a fire or something like that, because the library of Berlin is in the middle, is in the very near to the bunker of Hitler in the Second World War. There were a very harsh fight there, and so it was lost forever. We have no copies of this book. It is completely lost. But work for this occur on both sides. Also, we have in the British Library, this is a lot of a book from Pedro Tejedo, El Tejido de Teruel. This is a very well-known book. We see here that in the notes, it was destroyed in the Second World War. This, what is interesting of this record is because there has been for some years the idea of there was being some kind of lost book from Spanish Destreza that was lost during the Second World War. But I find it that the real book that was lost was a copy of Destreza. For us, we have the good idea that this book is not completely lost, but we have very few copies. But we have copies of this book, and of this book. We have a book that is written both in Spanish and Italian. It is published in Naples. Has been said before that it has been probably the composer was Italian, so there are more errors in the Spanish composition than in the Italian composition. But it's interesting because we see here that there are some special techniques, like see, this is a broqueles, this is not rodelas, because you see they are holding it by the hand. This is not a rodela, but a large broquel. This is a broquel or buckler, yes. And it's comparatively late because this is from the year 1675. And so, what is a very interesting view of the Destreza and in the Italian setting. So, in Italian, this is a knowledge of Destreza, and the Sicilian and Neapolitan tradition, they have a knowledge of Destreza, and probably they have some kind of interaction. And this is a picture of Pedro Tejedo. We have very few pictures of the Destreza masters. One of them. This is typical of the late 17th century, with long hair, with his mustache. Also, this is the coat of arms in the upper side of the picture. But the war is we have been producing some acquisitions that are very 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 close in our days, no? And we have the case of the I-33. It was a book that is belonging to a bibliothek in the Count of Gotha in Germany, but this bibliothek was removed during the end of the Second World War, and this book disappeared. But suddenly, oh, surprise! It appears in a auction in Sudsley in the 50s. And it was bought by the British government, and the first location was in the Tower of London. Sometimes it's called the Tower Manuscripts, and actual situations in the Leeds Royal Arbories. And here we have, this is from a fax line, the first thing I have. See the books, sometimes they have attached to it not only the text or the but notes from of annotations from people who were working with these books. We know a lot about this book. We talk a lot about the people who have been using it or who owned it before us, and so because the book is important not only by the text but also by the context or the paratext. Everything that is in the notes or the marks of possession are telling us a history of what happens with this book. Well, this is a well-known book. Everybody knows the idea, the Walpurgis and the monk fighting. And they what happens in this book. I have a very good facsimile of this book. I find something that was interesting for me. You see the shields, the bucklers, the small shields. It's a kind of brushing of something like that. Here you see it with a more intense, and not only in this backlash, but along the book. What is this? This is it happens. I think that in some moment of the history of this book, probably there was a child here. This they say, well, I had nothing to do there. Well, take this pencil and paint the seals in red. And so they many seals in these books are marked like this in a crayon, in a pencil, probably with some child who was playing with this book. Well, another war related acquisition is the case of a book that also belongs to the bibliotheque from Gotha in 1945, but this must disappear. But this book is not the case of E33. This book was split in isolated leaves and was sold in auctions as loose leaves in the 50s and 60s. And it happens that people from the United States bought all the leaves and he made united all the book again. Actually, it is in the New Haven in Connecticut in the Center for Yale Center for British Arts. Here is a paper from Dick Hagerdon, who is playing what all the processes of this dismounting and reconstructing of this book. And this book is the Gladiatoria. This is a nice book. We see a lot of fencing in armor, and there are other copies of this book, but this is a very important one. And I also it's interesting how this book was lost, but was also recovered or reconstructed, and we have now a nice copy of this book. This is completely recovered, and also an edition for Dick Hagerdon, a critical edition, very very nice. Well, another kind of books lost are books that are lost, but not completely lost. But they are going, they are in the shelves. They are there for the shelf for years. But the problem is we lost the access to these books. This is the case of the Godinho. The Godinho, you see here, this is a cover, this is a bomber. These books in one moment belonged to the Marquis of Pombal Library. The Marquis of Pombal was a Portuguese prime minister from in the 18th century. You see here, this is a square in Lisboa with a lot of traffic there. This is like a center of traffic. So you see it with a lion. People say that he has a lion, a tame lion, and he was a very important person there. And also, he suffers the Lisboa earthquake, and also reconstructed all the vice of Lisboa. You see the shape of the streets on the house of Lisboa is because they were because the Marquis of Pombal reconstructed it. He also spelled the Jesuits and was an illustrated man. She have an idea to improve the Portugal. And so he collect a library of books. He thinks that it was important. One of them was of this Godinho manuscript. And this book was in the library of Marquis of Pombal, and later it went to the Lisbon National Library. It was there for many years. You see there a page of the front page of this book. But what happens with many manuscript books, because it's very difficult to put it in files. And sometimes we have many manuscript books, but are not well described in the manuscripts. Sometimes it's very difficult to find where they are. The print books, it's very easy to make a file because there's a title, an author, and a place of publication, and a date. But sometimes manuscripts lack data. And so it's the files of manuscripts usually are not so good as printed books, and so it is difficult to find manuscript books. This happened. This is an example. This is the Pacheco manuscript from Berlin. This is the outside is parchment, and this is. The signs we have, it belonged to the Philips Library in Middle Hill, England, and later to the manuscript of Biblioteca of Regia, the Prussian Kingdom. This is a copy of Cien Conclusiones. This is a it's described in Leguina in another authors because they take the description from old records, but Leguina don't know where this book was because the track was lost when it was in the Philips collections, but we can track it, and we find it. That it's actually is in the Berlin National Library, and this we made it's interesting because it contains some very few drawings of Pacheco of different movements. Also, another book that's was lost or we can find it. This is the Oplosophia because recorded in old authors, but we don't know where it was until we found it in the library of the in Lisboa in the Academy of Science. And this is the picture of the first page. This is interesting because there are other things about only the text. You see the seal of arms, no? It's the seal of arms in the right side. There is a motto. This is Violenta Repugno. This is like the translation is I can. Something is spoken with, I can respond with violence, if I am attacked. We see this here in the this coat of arms in two parts. In the left part, we see five leaves, three leaves. This is the coat of arms of Figueiredo, the figo factory. And on the left side, we see that this is a four parts shield. This is an eagle, and also this is a tower in flames. This is the coat of arms of Bobadilla. This is a Spanish family names. In fact, the Figueiredos were called sometimes in contemporary sources as the Los Bobadilla, like some kind of contempt. Also, we saw here that the helm, you see the helm, this is the part of the shield that is the cover of the head that is over the shield of arms, is looking to the left side. But what is interesting is that because the right side, the helm looking to the left side was a note of astrology, because usually you see all the helms are looking to the right side. And so we have the Figueiredo, some kind of probably it's not clear, because I have a lot to investigate about this. What is the family connections, the Figueiredo, about his family, his family relationships, no? Because there was a son of Figueiredo with the same name. There was an expert on heraldry, in effect, he writes some books of heraldry. So it's not an error that is a clearly indicated sign. So in the book you have not only text, but you have a lot of information about another questions. This is on the left side, you see the one of the graphics of these books. So there's a lot of patterns for the script of the books. It was a nice book. It's a very nice handwriting and very clear. This is a very nice book. Well,
before we go on, Manuel, you were organized in the printing of that book, and if we have time, I think it would be interesting to hear a little bit about the process you went through getting that book published. Can you speak about that a little bit?
Yes, the Figueiredo books, the Oplosophia, we have the record from the Leguina, and also from Portugal, but actually, we don't know where the book was. We have to look from different libraries of Portugal until we find it where it was. It was a complex, probably the we have to one of the first who located this book was people from Brazil. Kawata. This is working on a thesis on this book. Also, the people also Hicks and Eric here, and many other people who were working also on locating this book and make a copy. Make this copy available. Also, sometimes we know there is a book. We know this book exists, but sometimes we lost the track in some place. And this book, we know this. We have records that this book exists, but we don't know where this book actually. And so, some kind of discovering of new discovering of this book, some books of them. You see that manuscripts sometimes are very hard to take because printed books is more standard, but the manuscripts sometimes in the many libraries are poorly recorded, and so this is sometimes it's difficult to find a manuscript. You have to find through secondary sources or personal search or something like that. And this is an example of a book that was lost, but was recovered not many years ago. It's a book that is only a manuscript, but this is located in a library of Lisbon, but it's not a very important library, and it's not easy to access to it. You have to go there and to ask for a copy, and it's not easy to access. Another case is very well known, the theory delivery. We know there are several copies, one in the Paul Getty, another one in the Pisani Dossi. It is interesting because this is a copy that is ordered by the family. In the beginning of the 20th century, was made a facsimile, but we have no further access to this copy. We have only access from the facsimile. We know the family owns these books, but it is completely out of reach, actually. There is another copy in the Morgan Pierpont Library, and there is the last copy that appeared very, very few years ago in Paris, in the National Library. It is the same. This is a manuscript about people with swords and fencing. But nobody knows what actually this manuscript was, another copy of the Fiori de Liberi. And this was Ken Monshain who find this manuscript, find because it was there, but made the connection. I think this is the important part. It made the connection that this manuscript actually was one copy of the Fiori de Liberi. And so there is a part of research, not only finding books, but identifying books and make the connections to another existing books. This is the case this is a manuscript, but it's actually in the library of the Oviedo University. But we find it that it's exactly the same text that another book. This book, this is the Compendio de las Definiciones y Principios de Diego Rejón de Silva. We have the text in the library. In part of the text is actually you can find it in the Tim Rivera page point is translated into English. The part with this meaning with master and the disciple. But what is interesting in this book is this late, comparatively late, this is the end of the 17th century. This almost contemporary to Rada, a small book. But this is most of them are definitions of clear definition of some terms of Destreza. And so we have the book, we have the manuscript, but we have to make the connection. We have to. We need people who knows the matter to make the connection between one thing and another. Sometimes it's not only to discover a new manuscript, but to identify and to put it in context with another books existing previously. This is something exactly what happens with Pedro Monte. Pedro Monte. This is a book writing in Latin, Exercitorium Artis la Collectania, as is known, probably one of the first books of writing on fencing or fighting. We see here. This is a distribution of where we can find today how many books. We see that in the north of Italy, there are a lot of them, where a couple of them in Spain, some of them in Germany, some of them in France. There are three of them in USA, but they come very late. But we see that the initial distribution of this book was in the Central Europe and Spain, and where we can find them. And one of the places we can find it is the library of La Biblioteca Colombina, the library of Hernando Colón. This is one of the sons of Cristóbal Colón. Of America fame, that made his fortune, and it was a very dedicated bibliophile. And they made a good collection of books, a very important collection of books. Also, he recorded how many costed the books and where he bought it. You have it. This kind of annotation on these books, where they were bought and the price he paid for it. Well, but this is the case. This book of the Pedro Monte was lost for many years, but was rediscovered from here in Anglo, but other people before that. This book was lost the track of it because people stopped to quote it because it was in Latin, which was not a very easy to use material, and we lost track of this book. We have records of these books. But we have not the actual book where it was belongs to, until we made the connections and reconnected where it belongs to. Also, this happens with a manuscript that is in the Escorial library, which is there, but. We don't know why they have no title, no have no author, but if we look to the content, it is the same as the Monte, but it's written in Spanish. And this is some kind of a compendium or a resume of the work of Monte, but it has been there for many years, but we have also to make the connection with the original. And further, in the 19th century, we see here on the left side is Gregorio Cruzado y Yamil, versus one of the precursors of the reconstruction of HEMA in Spain, before even the Hatton and all the English people. In the middle of the 19th century, they started to recover all the Spanish tradition of fencing. And the people from his entourage, he made a transcription of this manuscript from the Escorial. You see there on the right side, the transcript, the 19th century transcription of this manuscript from the 15th century. They don't know where it come from. They don't know where was the author, but they recovered it, and they made some guesses of where it's come from, and they made very clear guesses. They had some people who have an Italian background. He's a good fighter, and probably this is a very old text. So we have before us some people who are precursors, that they are working on these themes very, very long time before us. Unfortunately, there are some books that are lost forever. This is René Descartes, the famous French philosopher. It's to say that he has written a book of fencing in the 17th century, but it's recorded as lost in the late of the 17th century. Probably it's not going to change the course of the thinking of humanity, but there's a lost book of fencing from René Descartes. Sometimes it will appear, who knows, or not. And of course, there are the famous books lost forever, the books of Pons, Roman, or de la Torre, that probably, obviously, they were waiting. We have many, many records, we have many testimonies of people that say that they have seen them. There's an important work of Tim Rivera has made a reconstruction of the skeleton of these books. We have how many pages they have, we know what they are speaking about, we have the chapters they have, we know a lot of things about this book, but when we don't have the entire contents of this book, we have only the some kind of shape, some kind of skeleton of where these books are. We have to speculate because perhaps the Destreza masters tried to eliminate these books because they were some kind of heretical views or something like that. I don't know, but it's not idea that this is not can take place. And so this is a continuous track. I have to remind here one of the precursors of this. Tracking. This is Sousa Viterbo. This is a man from the turn of the 19th to 20th century from Portugal. He was a medical doctor, but he was not working as a doctor because he was a journalist and write a book. So this is Ciriba in Portugal. This is a first book about the fencing books in Portugal. It's a very important book. I make a kind of a profile of very old books. And from reading a copy of this book in Madrid, in the Madrid National Library, I found a slip of paper who said that there was a book of fencing in Coimbra. And so I followed this track and I found this book. This is a manuscript of Coimbra. Actually, you see these nice pictures. This is a manuscript that includes several books. These are books that are translations of Pacheco into Portuguese, contemporary translation of Pacheco, but also includes a translation of Viedma into Portuguese, a contemporary translation of Viedma into Portuguese. So, we saw that this the Destreza was a common ground between Spain and Portugal, and there was translation from one language to the other. Perhaps it's not as spectacular as information, but it's a very, very important information. We say that what will share because between Spain and Portugal. And the interesting thing that this was why, like the author of this book, the author, they tried to pass it under his name, and so attributing the merit of the book, but Luisa Isas de Fonseca. But when you compare the text, you see that actually this is the same text as Pacheco and Viedma. Probably because of the Portugal-Spain relationships deteriorated when Portugal set apart from Spain in the after some years they were joined under the King Felipe II and the Terror at the Fort, and Portugal tried to make some way, but Portugal serves also the tradition of the stress. It's a shared tradition between Spain and Portugal. Also, they include a book of Tomás Luis. Also, this is a complete encyclopedia of Portuguese fencing. No? We have paid an edition of this book in our library. Well, we're coming to an end, and we are to speak on some books that appeared very, very recently. One of these is the Cabero. This is a kind of a primer of the Destreza. This book actually is a collector in Italy. It's a book of about the Destreza, but this has owned the manuscript. This is in the hands of the family for many years, the family of Cabero. This is the Count of Sobradell. This is a noble family from Aragon in Spain. These books belongs to the family for centuries until they recently sell it. Interesting because this, you see there, this is very Portuguese Destreza, well, many of, well, you see, there is another book that also was recently back into life. We have some glimpses about this. This is the, in the library of Louvain, we have a book that is like a book, a trace, made a copy, made on trace paper of some old book. I have no idea where this book was or where it came from. Only we have the trace copy of this this book. This was put into life by Matt Gallas, who was there. And I made a publication about this kind of book. But recently, we have access to the actual book. We see here that is a book from 1625. This is writing for Octavio Ferrada. This is a master of fencing in Madrid. And he was the teacher of an Austrian novel. Probably he writes the books for the use of this novel. And probably this book was taken to Central Europe. Probably it was there from the years, and until recently it came back to light. But this is an example. There are books there that can be appear in any moment, anyhow. So we have books there. This is another book. This is the case of Mendes de Carmona. Also, this is we have the portraits, one of the few masters we have portraits. We have Lores de Rada, we have no portraits of Lores de Rada, but we have portraits of Mendes de Carmona. This is a book. This is we have the plates printed, the author, the front page, some kind of a coat of arms. But the rest of the book, this is a manuscript. Where is this manuscript now? This manuscript is actually is in the hand of a book dealer. But the problem is that he's asking for this book as much as $35,000. And it is a very high price. And the problem is that it's not lowering the price, it's raising the price as the years go by, that they are raising the price. We have now a book there, but the problem to access to this book is that we cannot have the $25,000 we are asking that. Perhaps we can make a crowdfunding, but probably we can reach so high a quantity, taking in account that there are not so many people interested in the Destreza. But yeah, we have a books. Probably this book is going to remain there until some years, and in one moment, perhaps this book can come back to the market. The price actually is too high. Nobody is going to pay this price. And how this is going to be solved? Probably in some years, this book can be sell, so to say, by the back door. For once you have put a price in the market, you cannot go back. And so if you sell it, you can sell it, but for the back door, for a lesser price. This book is actually in a price that is too high for what a book of this kind can be paid. Well, this is the Biblioteca Joanina in the University of Coimbra, where this one is the Biblioteca da Ciuda in Lisbon. This one is the Library of the Science Academy in Lisbon. This one is the Agustin Sal in the Library of Austria. And this one is the Library of Congress. You see, there's a lot of nice places to go to for look for books, and are very pleasing places. I find they are very very pleasant and very nice, and you don't only with can examine books, but also to have a pleasant time in this spectacular places. Well, it's open. The discoveries ahead. This only the starting point. We have to follow this road. Thank you.
So, Manuel, I think we should take some time for questions, or did you have anything else that you'd like to speak about? I think you are muted.
A small presentation of all the possibilities we have to search books or to find books. We are going to find new books. They are there. We say that it's impossible to find new books. We are going to find new books. Sometimes they are in private hands, sometimes they are under another covers. We are searching, but I have been in this business for some years, and every year I find new things. So also, sometimes it's not a new book, but sometimes it's a book that is improperly identified, or sometimes that this is a version of a book that is different from the original, or something, things like that. But it's not ended. This work is not ended.
So I have questions. Tim Ribeira wants to know, what is your current project or projects that you're working on?
Oh, a lot of them. Well, actually, I have almost ready a version there of a book of a master of Andalusia. Garay. It's almost ready. I have to check a couple of things, because this is a very rare book. This is a very few exemplars, and I have to check where one of them is published, so it's very near to be published. Also, I am working on Grandezas edition, critical edition, and also in a Carranza critical edition, because I think that it's important to have a clean text where we can work. There are some current Grandezas translations on working, and I don't know, probably the Grandezas translation edition maybe is not interesting to be published, but somehow we can make it accessible, because it's it's useful to use it for people who are working on Pacheco and Carranza, you know, that is things. And we have another things, we're working in a lot of projects. I also have working a translation of the world, into Spanish, and translation of a new edition of Godinho, and a Portuguese version of Godinho, because Godinho is written half in Spanish, half in Portuguese. Probably we are going to make a new edition in both Spanish and Portuguese, also regular Spanish and regular Portuguese. No, we have made a two-side version. A lot of things. We're working all the time. Yeah.
So I have a question. The story is that Carranza had written more than just one book. Have you ever found any evidence of later books?
Yes, he was. He writes the fencing books. He writes the book of, the famous book. Right? He also writes another book of is about dueling and injuries and all that. This is a copy. Actually, this is manuscript in Sevilla, in the cathedral, in the library of Cologne. But there is also a copy in Amberes, in the library of planting, a handscript copy also. He said that he was reading something about some kind of expansions of the Destreza, but actually we don't have any evidence that he actually writes something about that. Also, while working with people from Sevilla, from edition of one of the disciples of Carranza in America. This is Galacia. It was the first book published of fencing in the American continent. It was published in Venezuela. In Guatemala in the 17th century. This is written by a disciple of Carranza. He said that this is a direct disciple of Carranza. We don't know exactly if it's a direct disciple of Carranza or a disciple of Sevillian school of fencing. But this interesting point. No? But we know that this book is a very small book, so very, very short, but interesting because this is declared as a Carrancist follower and explains some points of the Carranza doctrine. No? We are working on that. There is a very, very, very few exemplars. There is one in Guatemala and another one in Paris in the Versailles Library. I know there are not another exemplars, very rare. And probably we are going to publish it recently, working on that. It's a lot of things. It can't stop.
So it's all really interesting. Tim has just said he feels like it's like a little kid at Christmas time listening to your projects and the things that you're finding. We have another question. The story is that Rada was working on another book when his ships burned. Do you have any evidence of any of that surviving?
Yes. Rada says that the story of Rada is when he went to America first time as a governor of Veracruz. Veracruz was very important because the port of exit of all the Mexican silver and wealth, and also from all the woods that come from Asia through the Manila Galleon. And so they get a lot of wealth, also of political influence, and then he resigned and came back to Spain. When he came back to Spain with the fleet, usually the fleet go to Sevilla, but there was a English and Dutch fleet that was that was chasing the Spanish fleet, and they have to make the tour to Vigo, and so they get a refuge in Vigo, and there they were chased by the British and Dutch. He said that was lost one of his book he has written. But actually, probably this book was of the book of Nobleza de la Espada, that he spent some years in Spain working to achieve his marquisdom or his new position as registrador mayor of Mexico. And during this time, probably he reconstructed the book. Probably he lost the book. He lost was a sketch or a version of this Nobleza de la Espada. He was a person with a lot of work capability. Very, you see, it's impressive that the book and having. Working on his the book, his part of the quotations, and this is very accurate. And this is take a lot of quotations from many books, and they are very accurate. Not as Pacheco that is lazy quoting people, things taken from another book, from another book, from another book. No. Rather. Take things seriously. Rada is very serious, yes. And so probably he lost probably the drawer of this book, but he can reconstruct it and he published the books, the Nobleza de la Espada, during the time he was in Spain. At this time also he was making his political career and his he was achieving, or actually he bought the charge of registrador. Registrador is the is like I don't know exactly what it's in English. This is the is the one. This is in the charge of taking every kind of. Economic transaction or everything that can be released, can be taking records, and has to pay a fee for this kind of registration from Mexico. But it is includes all Mexico and all his the even America and. North America and Asia and Philippines and also that. And so this was very important. In fact, when Rada dies, his office was splitted in several parts. The Jesuits have something to do with that because Rada was very close to the Jesuits. In fact, he leaves his wealth to the Jesuits to make the California Pius Fund to Christianize all the these pagans from California and that so and that so well it's a long story and so the when the Jesuits were expelled the Franciscans took charge of California, no, and the missions on everything that. But the Jesuits where we started the Christianization of California. But the story went on, and later the Mexican government took the Rada. It was a kind of I don't know. Ese nombre que usa es herencia. Es herencia. Lois, ¿cómo se dice herencia? La herencia de algo.
Lois, you're muted.
Bueno, es, this is the...
It's a, you've inherited something. You've inherited, it's come down to you.
Es, heritage, exactly, the heritage, eso es. La herencia, or rather, left his, all his inheritance to the, to these, to the Jesuits, Christianize California. Later, the Vatican government took the Rada properties, but there was an interesting history because in the, at the beginning of the La Haya, the Hague courtship, one of the first they have was the American government against the Mexican government about the Rada inheritance, because the American government said that the inheritance of Rada was the inheritance of Rada was dedicated to finance the Catholic Church in California. The Mexican government said, no, this one is now, it's now ours. And the American government win. And the Mexican government has to pay in silver all the left things that they have from the time of Rada until the beginning of the 19th century, or the 20th century. Yes, interesting case.
So you're saying that California is built with Destreza money?
Yes, Rada put his money in California.
We have more questions. The quickest is do you know how Rada died?
How Rada died? There's no record. He dies comparatively young, because I see that he was 50, 60, no older than 60 years. He dies we have no records. Perhaps in Mexico, I have contacts here. They say they come, they have some documents about Rada household of people of his servants or something like that. But we have not many details of life of Rada in Mexico. We know he married his cousin, his wife, who was his cousin. He has been married before. He was a widow. I think he was widowed two or three times before, because they were people from Cantabria, Santander, where I was born. They were all of them. They were related, and they were this like kind of a community of merchants. They have the a kind of a community of people that were ruling the economy of Mexico, and so he tried to disperse the wealth, and so they usually marry between close relatives. He has no children, and when he died, his wealth went to the Jesuits, but the title went to a nephew. The nephew make a trial against the Jesuits, trying to get the inheritance, but he lost. He get the title, but not the money. actually, the title is Spacant. It's not any people holding the title of Marqués de las Torres de Rada, because he dies because in Spain, for to get a title, you have to reclaim it after the holder of the title dies. You have to make a process to reclaim the title. If nobody reclaims the title is vacant. Actually, the title of Marqués de las Torres de Rada is vacant. Actually, it's not any Marquis of Torres de Rada. Some years before, there has been a corrupt mafia in Spain trying to reclaim titles. One of them was the title of Torres de Rada. They forged titles on that, but he trying to reclaim all titles that were vacant. But they were discovered, and actually it became again. So, well, I am going to say this. I can reclaim the title of Marquis of Torres de Rada because I am related with Rada by his wife. It's Salcines, wife of the family names of his wife. We are very near. I am from Cataluña, from Santander. I'm very near, and I have very, very long relations with Rada. But I can take my relationship with Rada, but it's very, 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 very long. And in case I can claim the title, because it can take a lot of time of money. I'm not going to do it, but in case of you need a Marquis of Torres de Rada, I am the pretender of the title.
So there's been a vote in the chat, and everyone would like you to do it.
Yes.
that's wonderful. So I do have a couple of more questions. If somebody wanted to help with this work or keep an eye out and watch for these books, what could somebody do? And if they find something, do you have a contact point, maybe through AGEA's website? How can they help with this work?
Most of the work we are doing there, AGEA Editorial, is a collaborative work. You see many of the authors and other people, sometimes people with more or less abilities to do research work or transcription work, but we try to imply many people in doing things, and usually we try to help things, to help people to do. If you are helped, you are guided, you can do a lot of work. It is not a work to do alone, but it's you can publish a lot of work because we have many people working, and so I think that this is the important point. Everybody can make a thing. You see that a transcription. Many people can do transcription. Can be a transcription of more or less quality. It's the same. This is a transcription. This is a first step. If you have a rough transcription, you can correct it and you can use it. And it is a lot of work. You have a lot of work done. So it's everybody can put a little bit in this kind of things. I think it's important that everybody can collaborate. You have to have a kind of coordination of a kind of have a set of rules or have some kind of grid of coordinates you have to work on with, but I think that this is very important. All the work we have done is because we have a lot of people working with us and collaborating and doing a lot of work. You see, it's impossible for one person can do as a lot of work as we do.
That's really great. I think a lot of people are interested in helping with things like that. I have another question here. Some of the people in the chat have described you as a sort of a James Bond who shows up in a tuxedo and a nice suit and can get into any library in the world.
Yes. This is you need some kind of office for this. You see the in Indiana Jones kind of worker things. This is but really it happens that. If you go to a library with my seriously dress with a suit and my glasses, I have a round glasses. I usually wear it when I go to a library. This is the people from the library. See, oh, yes, these are very respectable researchers. But if you go there dressed and casual. Probably the librarian is not going to show you your treasures. Well, there's a language, a body language for working in libraries. I am getting a lot of help from librarians from many libraries in the world, from librarians and from. I remember from the Stockholm, the Librus Kammare, the people there, the librarian there, show me a file from books from the Glasgow Library, and then with this go to another place. Also, you share things. This is like you share things. Share a file from that, and then he shows you that. Also, you show your say, this book, this interesting book. You have a very nice book here. This is the one thing that you have only have two in the world. I don't know that. This is it. And you see there, this is the, there is a mistake here from the data. I don't know that. And so you interact with the librarians and they usually reward you because if you present something to them, they also reward you with another presence. Also, what happens is when you go to a library, you have to go to something in mind or to something to catch something. If you go, here, young. What have you about the stress? I said, nothing to do there. I didn't say, please show me the is 7073. Oh, there's no problem. They come here and show you that book. If you know that the is 73 is a book about the stress, they come here and then when they come with the book, say, do you know that this is the only book in the world about the stress in the world? I don't know that. There is a surprise for us, and everybody is happy. No, these are interchanges of information between the librarian and you. And so, if you help the librarian make this work, this is to classify, identify the books. They help you allowing you to access to some sources that sometimes are not easy to access. I remember accessing for instance, in the Oviedo library one summer when everybody was in holidays. I go there and say, I'm going to look for some book. I don't know where. There is a file there with an old file with a paper file. I started searching there many books that were not in the digital files, were only on the paper files. And you have to go there and to search one by one all the thousands of titles in the file, trying to find something that was interesting for you. But that is what, how it is happens. You search, you find things. Actually, most of the files that are digitalized, and we can find it. It's easy because many of the world can do it in the internet, and most of the archives are digitalized, or the books are digitalized. If you ask for a book, if you request a book, you request a copy. The book is request a digitalization and pay for it. This book, in some years, will be released to the people of opening. And so this is a way to open the files to the rest of the community. If you make a requirement for a digitalization of some archives or some book, with in due times, it will be open to all the community.
That's really, really interesting. So we did have another question. I don't want to keep you too long, but some of the people have wanted to know if you have visited libraries in the New World, or if you've, where are the different libraries that you have visited? Maybe one library stands out as a particular example.
Well, library, woof. So many. For me, one I love most is the AGEA library in Lisbon. That is where is the Thomas Luis copy, and the other books, and the people there are very friendly. And there is a library that is very few people there, but it's usually when we go there, usually I was the only people there working there. I also have to speak about the library of Louvain. They are very friendly and they have a lot of material. Very friendly. It's very difficult because I can't find, except in one or two libraries that I were in Spain that were have some problems. In the most of the libraries and all the world, I have full access, and the people there were completely generous, and they show me all they have and they help me a lot. And sometimes some libraries they have restrictions. You can only order perhaps two or three books a day. Yes, the rules. But having sometimes, sorry, I come here from Spain and I'm going to be here only for 2 days. No problem. They show me all the books they have and they move all the things and they have putting things, the librarians are nice people, yes, I love them.
That's really amazing. I'm afraid that we could keep you here for the rest of the day. If you did not know this audience, it is actually, we started at 3 a.m., 3 in the morning, at Manuel's time. So I think the sun is just now rising where you are. So we should bring an end to this. But I just want to say that getting up in the middle of the night to provide a lecture for us, that is a really heroic thing for you to do, and we all really appreciate it. So thank you so much.
Thank you for all your interest. I think that this, I'm very passionate about this, but I feel that I can help if I love what I am doing, and I think that there's a great deal of work to be done, and as last as I can, I go on. I thank you for your interest, because I have a lot of things to do. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, everyone. I think that will conclude our lecture. Manuel, I hope you have a good day, and I hope that you get some sleep.
Thank you. Thank you.
Next week, our lecturer will be Alberto Bompresi, who is the director of AIA, and I'll put information out on the web for that lecture tomorrow.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you too. Thank you.